Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Sunbury Motors, North 4th Street in Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf.
This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now, from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Good afternoon, everybody. It is the Steve Jones Show on a Wednesday. Matt Catrillo here with you. Steve will soon be there from the Sunbury Motors Studio. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. And online at sunburymotors.com. Ford, Kia, Hyundai, great selection of new and pre-owned inventory. Great sales staff that is there for you. And not just there for the sale to get you the right deal. And a service department to back it all up that's there with the diagnostics, the inspections, all the routine maintenance. It's all part of the Sunbury Motors guarantee. All at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf. And online at sunburymotors.com. It is Wednesday, so Steve typically running a little bit behind schedule as he's coming back from the quarterback club with James Franklin and others. As Penn State back in action this week, UMass on Saturday afternoon for homecoming. They'll have the Legends of Greatness jerseys on this week. So we'll have all that good stuff coming up. 3:30 kick, 2 o'clock, the airtime over on Eagle 107 with Steve and Jack and the gang there. So Steve coming up, I think, from the Sunbury Motors studio. I've got clear levels from his end after yesterday's mishap. So hopefully we should be good to go there. Apologize again for that yesterday, but we made it work. That's all I could say. We made it work. There we go. James Franklin's press conference was quite interesting yesterday. But the one I'm going to focus on, I guess, came after the fact, where there's a report out there by Athlon Sports, and it's a typical, really, it's a good website for if you want to try to place a bet on a game or you want to get predictions on games and stuff like that. In terms of actual reporting, it's really one of those clickbaity type of sites. And that's exactly what this report they put out here. James Franklin was asked yesterday about the Big Ten, about scheduling non-conference opponents with the Big Ten schedule, the way it's going to be going forward with expansion. And he talked about that there was a team, he didn't name the team, that was pulling out of already agreed to contracts with non-Big Ten opponents. But he was just explaining that that's just the way things were because things are about to change. And he was going through what Penn State's philosophy was if you go with opponents like a Delaware, for example, it helps you ramp up for the better competition, and we talked about that a couple weeks ago. So he was kind of combining that answer with saying that this is what other schools are doing. So he's backing up what Penn State is doing. This is now other schools are trying to do the same thing. But this report by Athlon came out as saying as James Franklin was calling out that said opponent for doing that. I mean, you guys, people have to listen. Learn how to listen to these answers. If you go back and read this report, they make it sound like he's calling out somebody. But if you go back and listen to what he's saying, he's just explaining that's just the way things are now. And he's absolutely right. Things are going to change. And guess what? The way Penn State's done things with non-conference opponents already, it's been working. So once again, we have 2023 today, lazy journalism at its finest for clickbait. Turning nothing into something and taking James Franklin's words out of context as maybe other teams can use this as bulletin board material. Stop it. That's just the way things are. So obviously, the person who wrote this has no idea what Penn State's been doing as far as their approach to non-conference opponents, has no idea how this is going to change the scheduling purposes and all the nuances of that with expansion starting next year with UCLA and USC, and doesn't just understand that period and just have one goal in mind to get clickbait. That's just unbelievable. I mean, really. That's lazy journalism. And that's just a dangerous precedent to set. Because you never know. Maybe somebody in the Big Ten might take that and not take the time to go listen back to what James actually said and then start spreading more rumors about that. That's not good journalism at all. That's the exact opposite of what you want to do as a reporter. So I saw that, and I didn't see the press conference yesterday, so I actually took the time, like most people don't do nowadays, and went back to listen to what he had to say about it, and it is literally the complete opposite to what James Franklin said. It really is just unbelievable sometimes with this clickbait society. And it's not necessarily what the fault of these writers. It's the fault of the corporate world that's taking over print journalism. They want to all these people see is not the quality of the content that's out there. It's just what's bringing in the money? What's bringing in the views? Is this making it worthwhile? My while, regardless of what the content looks like. And it's pretty sad, to be honest with you, of how this is going now. In terms of media, in terms of long-form journalism and all these sorts of things. What's happened with The Athletic, we've talked about that before. It's pretty sad. It's just the way the press... This is what people that work on these websites are being told to do. So that way they can get maybe an eighth of what they're actually going to be worth making of an article that they write for. So say if you're paid like $25 an article, you're probably getting $3 out of it. If you even get a certain amount of views before the company takes it back. Because I used to do some of these websites when I first graduated from school. Because I actually thought it was a good way to maybe get my name out there. It's not. It's not. I'd recommend anybody that's trying to get into this, don't go that route. Don't do it. They're just putting you down a rabbit hole that's, to me, going to set you up for failure and is going to teach you the wrong things. So I just saw that, and that's definitely my first rant of the day. But I'll save my second rant for later, because I want Steve to hear at least one of these today. It's my favorite part of the day. How could it not be at this point? So we'll hear from Steve, hopefully on the other side, coming back from quarterback club as we get set for Penn State and UMass on Saturday. Today's show brought to you by Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. Got a question, comment, whatever, 570-743-9565. We're at Steve Jones PSU on Twitter and Steve Jones Show on Facebook. Back after this, here on the Steve Jones Show, brought to you by Sunbury Motors.
There's something to be said about a sale with a handshake. A service technician who really knows what he's doing. They can explain it in English what the problem is. There's nothing better than having that friend you could trust in the area. That's Sunbury Motors, where you get selection, knowledgeable salespeople, and prices that fit your budget, and more important, that friend you can trust. Welcome to Sunbury Motors, Kia, Ford, and Hyundai. You could shop other dealers and compare prices, but at Sunbury Motors, you get their lowest price promise. They research the current used vehicle market and guarantee their used car prices are the lowest. If you find a lower price, Sunbury Motors will beat it. Three dealers all in one. See their full new and pre-owned inventory at sunburymotors.com. Pick out a vehicle you like and schedule your test drive online. Follow them on Facebook. Sunbury Motors Ford and Hyundai, North 4th Street, Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf.
We'll be right back.
Back here on the Steve Jones Show, Mac Catrillo here with you. Steve will soon be there in the Sunbury Motors studio. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. Steve finishing up at quarterback club as Penn State back in action this week, taking on UMass for homecoming on Saturday afternoon. So he'll be back from that in just a little bit. Meanwhile, we've got the MLB postseason continuing. The Rangers stunningly just sweep the O's really with relative ease. I'm surprised of how bad that went for the O's, considering they had home field advantage, but they lose that in a sweep. Texas moves on. They await the winner between the Astros and the Twins. Astros took a 2-1 series lead yesterday with a big 9-1 win yesterday, two home runs by Abreu. So it might be all Texas in the ALCS. We'll have to see about that. But Texas, they look very dominant. At the same time as the O's kind of squandered it a little bit, came out and laid an egg. Texas is kind of looking like how they were the beginning half of the season, where they looked pretty impressive on all facets of the game. So they're an interesting team to continue to watch as they await their opponent for the ALCS. Then, of course, the Phillies back in action tonight, trying to bounce back from the tough one on Monday night in Game 2. That's a 5:07 first pitch, so it's an hour earlier than it has been. Normally, it's been a 6 o'clock first pitch with this series. Tonight, it's 5:07 at Citizens Bank Park with Aaron Nola on the hill for the Phillies tonight. And like I said to Steve yesterday, and actually the Astros Twins series is game four is tonight as well. So the Astros at 7:07 in Minnesota. So the Astros will try to win that series tonight. But getting back to the Phillies, as I said to Steve on the show yesterday, because of the way the Braves came back and won that game, the winner of this game tonight wins the series. I think it's going to be that critical. Because if you're the Braves, you have all the momentum right now. And if you find a way to go into Citizens Bank Park and win tonight, that just adds to it. And then you get through both Phillies' aces, and we're not sure what the plan is going to be for the Phillies in Game 4. I presume they're going to go back to Ranger Suarez, but I'm not sure yet. I don't think Rob Thompson has said. But that to me kind of says we're the best team in the league. You've finally awoken them, and then they beat you again. And I think they just go in and take cover and don't want to take a chance of going back to a Game 5 where you have to face Zach Wheeler again. But if the Phillies can win tonight, then they basically take all the momentum they had back, put the Braves back on their heels, and then you get another home game regardless of who's pitching. And let's face it, Citizens Bank Park is the toughest place to play in baseball right now. In the postseason. I think it was to begin the postseason, but now, in particular, it is. So that's why I think tonight's game is really critical and going to determine who wins this series. I could be wrong, but we'll see here. But man, that was really a missed opportunity for the Phillies on Monday night. But the truth of the matter is, when you look back at that game, you can try to blame the call on the walk that kind of jump-started the rally for the Braves a little bit. As a home plate umpire, there was a little bit on the inconsistent side. You can blame Harper for not tagging up at the end of the game, which I agree with Steve. I don't think he did anything wrong there. I think that was just a spectacular play at the right time for the Braves. You can blame all these certain things, but what happened to the Phillies yesterday, while it's unfortunate, or Monday night, while it's unfortunate, that's baseball. That's simply baseball. And the Astros took advantage of an opportunity when they got a two-out walk. Zach Wheeler and Rob Thompson made the right decision to stick with Zach Wheeler because there were a couple other jams, like the Turner error and this and that, or a different error. It wasn't by Turner. It was a different person that made the error. But regardless, there was a walk, whatever. There were a couple times guys still got on base when Zach Wheeler was cruising, and he got out of it with relative ease. Same thing here. The guy worked a two-out walk, didn't quite get the call. You leave him in there to try and work out of it, because that's how it's been. That's how he's been. He's been getting out of those ways. He was brilliant in the first 5 2/3. It just so happened that the following at bat, Braves get their first hit, and that just kind of, and their bats just woke up. That happens sometimes in baseball. And then at the end of the game, Braves make a spectacular play in right center field, and Bryce Harper's caught doubled up, because that's a tough catch to make. 9 times out of 10, that's going to hit off the wall probably, and the way Bryce was running, he probably scores, ties the game. Who knows what happens then? So I think just sometimes we have to go look back at it and not try to play the blame game, even though I know that's something that I do quite frequently. So this is coming from me, who does that often. I look back at that game Monday night, and that's just baseball. And unfortunately, it just didn't go the Phillies' way. So that's why I think the Phillies do have the right attitude, and that, you know what, we at least got the split. It's not necessarily calling it one of those moral losses, because it's still a tough loss. They still had a missed opportunity. You blew a 4-0 lead on the road to the best team in baseball with a chance to go up 2-0 and close them out at home. But it's not that anybody did one thing wrong or the other. It's just, it was baseball. It went the Braves' way. You still got the split. Now you come home and see what you can do and try to win these next two games at home. And obviously, don't worry about a game five or whatever. That was my takeaway from that game. But I do think that this game is, the winner of this game tonight is going to determine the winner of this series, because of the way the momentum shifted so vastly in game two for the Braves. So that's just my 2 cents on that. And then elsewhere tonight, NHL just opened up its regular season yesterday. Flyers opened up their season tonight in Columbus against the Blue Jackets. The Penguins dropped their season opener at home last night to the Blackhawks 4-2. So you have that going on as well. NBA in the preseason, Sixers had the Celtics tonight in the second game of the preseason. Probably not going to see anybody notable play on either side. We'll see who else is going tonight. You have Canadians Maple Leafs tonight, Senators Hurricanes tonight. Blackhawks right back at it in Boston against the Bruins. Jets Flames, Oilers Canucks, Avalanche Kings. So that's the NHL slate. And the Flyers, there's a lot of this talk about this being a new era of orange now. Let's see. I still have very, very low expectations, but we'll see if this new era in the air provides an early season spark. That's pretty much all I have to say about that. So next half hour, SI.com's Neal Coolong is going to join us with his take on the Steelers' dramatic yet weird win against the Ravens on Sunday. Of course, we didn't get a chance to have him yesterday with our technical issues, so he'll join us today at 1:35. That's coming up next. And Steve, of course, will be back from in the Sunbury Motors studio from the Quarterback Club. Then at 2:06 today, ticket manager is Tony Knopp with the latest on business of sports, the realignment. We haven't talked to him since the Big Ten added two more teams in Oregon and Washington. So we got a lot going on today in the next couple half hours of the show. Neal Coolong is next in the next half hour here on the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK, brought to you by Sunbury Motors.
This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now, from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, online at sunburymotors.com. Ford, Kia, Hyundai, the best new inventory with great warranties. Fabulous pre-owned inventory with the Sunbury Motors Guarantee and a terrific service department that backs it all up every step of the way at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, online at sunburymotors.com. It is always a pleasure to welcome back the outstanding Neal Coolong. My good friend, thank you so much for your time today. Do I get him there? Yeah, there we go. I think I get you now. Hello, Neal.
Am I here now?
Yes, you've been there the entire time. The question is, did I have the ability to reel you in?
Well, 15 seconds ago, I was happy to be here, and I'm still happy to be here now. So
perfect.
We're all good.
That's what we do. How on the face of the earth are the Pittsburgh Steelers 3-2? I watched that team, and there's no way they should be 3-2.
I don't know, but is this not the same thing we've been saying over the last three seasons now?
Yeah.
It the only thing they do well is win games. And I initially had said that as like a joke, and it was like 2 years ago, but it's the truth. I mean, to be fair, the defense went off the rails in the second half. I mean, that was one of the best half performances I think they've had in quite a while. It was impressive to see. Definitely took a big step forward with that. But offensively, snap to snap, you don't know what they're doing or why they're doing it. They should not be a 3-2 team. But the funny thing is, It the manner in which these games are being played, I don't think they've played a good game out of five. And I can make as many arguments that they should be 1-4 as I can they should be 4-1.
Right.
And once again, we just have no sense of who this team is. But as a coach, and I said this about Baltimore leading into the game, Harbaugh will eventually decide that he wants to play it safe against Pittsburgh's defense. And what's going to happen is they're going to take it away from them. If you give them the opportunity to play the game in the muck, they're going to take you down there, and they are more than comfortable winning that way. If they have to block a punt through the end zone to win, if that's going to get the ball back to them, and then from there, if their offense makes one play the entire game, it's going to be the biggest play of the game, and you're going to find yourself on the losing end of a game you had no business losing. And John Harbaugh, of all people, should know that because the Steelers have done that something four or five times the last 3 years to him. It's crazy the amount of times they have been able to beat Baltimore, largely because the Ravens don't want to play above the Steelers' level. And I don't mean talent-wise. I just mean Jackson threw well. You know, they dropped a bunch, and that doesn't help. But
right.
They did plenty to win that game until they decided they had to be simple with everything, and they couldn't just kind of continue doing what they were doing early. And they let the Steelers back in the game, and the Steelers' defense made two plays on them. Jackson screwed up pretty badly twice, and they allowed a block punt. That's how the Steelers win these kinds of games. And by law of averages, you shouldn't be able to do this more than once a season, but it's like all of their wins now. It's remarkable and crazy, and I can't figure it out. I've tried for 2.5 years now. I just know that it will continue, and I don't think that they'll be able to do it next week either, and they probably will.
So, yeah, Jackson did some good things, but this is the part that baffles me. You get down to the 5-yard line, whatever they are. You know, and this is right before the Joey Porter Jr. interception, which is a good play by Joey. But how do you have a guy with the legs of Lamar Jackson and not attempt to utilize them there? To me, it's like, I think everybody's trying to make him into this thrower all the time to prove to the world he throws the ball. He's been in the league long enough. He throws the ball decently, not great. And guess what? The guy can run. I don't understand why Baltimore doesn't take advantage of that when they've got a chance to put the game away.
The funny thing is, the play that I would look at that described that perfectly was the one that the Ravens won't admit it and they won't speak about it. But I believe it was the end of the first half. They had the ball inside the 20,
yeah,
or maybe it was inside the 30. They wanted to get a field goal at the end. And for whatever reason, Jackson ran the play. I think it was on fourth down. Harbaugh obviously wanted to run the clock down while they're at the line in case, you know, the Steelers jump or something like that. Jackson snapped it.
Yeah.
And they're not blocked up for it. Watt was left untouched, which, you know, I don't know if they've paid attention. That's not the guy to let go free.
I'm trying to think.
And
yeah, you might be right about that.
Watt immediately comes in and cuts off Jackson's running option.
Right.
And right there, it's like it's almost as if Jackson wanted to hike the ball so we could run, but even the defense wasn't going to let him run in that situation. Point being, you can tell Harbaugh on the sideline was amazed that the ball was snapped. It seemed to me like the ball was never supposed to be snapped. But at a 10,000-foot level, it was like it was the only opportunity where it looked like Lamar wanted to run the ball.
Right.
It's as if everybody is telling him not to, and I agree with you. He's a good thrower. He's not a great one.
Right.
He can do some damage with his arm, but his dual threat is what makes it who he is.
That's right.
And he did some stuff early. You know, yep. He got loose a little bit. It wasn't designed, but that stopped. You know, and it really kind of seemed more like, hey, Lamar, we're up. We're nursing a lead. Do not run the ball, okay? Don't leave the pocket. Do not run the ball. Because he tightened up. And the interception, good for Joey Porter Jr. He's right where he's supposed to be. He played that perfectly, but he's not going to get an interception in the NFL easier than that. I mean, wow. I don't know what was wrong with Jackson on that throw, but that was terrible.
Yep.
Mistakes like that lose a game. And it seems to me, just pure speculation and observation, it seems to me like there's some type of mandate being put on Jackson to not run in certain situations. You know, not, I don't even mean necessarily third and four, don't ever run. I mean, clock is this, score is this, quarter is this, don't run. We don't want you to run. These are the things we want you to do. But at the same time, when you have, you know, seven drops, five of them were just catastrophically bad, you need somebody on your team to you know, generate offense. And Jackson was the only guy that was doing that.
Right.
And did a pretty good job of it. Cutting him loose seems to be kind of the way he wants to play. He's comfortable playing. I don't know why they do that, but the Steelers certainly thank him.
You have to play defense to your offense and offense to your defense. Well, in this case, we know the Steeler offense is treading water. Are they doing a good enough job, in your opinion, of playing defense to their offense? Meaning, look, I'll give you an example. We talked about Iowa a couple weeks ago. Iowa does everything in their power not to let any receiver get behind them. Everything. You can run a double move, they won't bite, they got to stay back. Because their offense can't make up for it. Are the Steelers doing a good enough job of playing defense to their offense?
That's a tough one. A game like Sunday, because they needed to get the ball back multiple times and they needed to not allow any points to give the offense absolutely every chance that it had. But it's such a spontaneous defense. They really work you to a point where you, as an offense, you've exposed yourself to the defense, allowing the defense to make a play on you. That's really what the defense did. Larry Ogunjobi, a veteran in the league, runs your skill guy down from behind and plays it perfectly, forces a fumble. He may as well have been T.J. Watt on that play. It's exactly what Watt would have done. It's obvious that it's an emphasis within their defensive room, but those kinds of things are offensive for the Steelers. Right. So my question is, not only are they setting it up for the offense, it's almost more like we're just taking over the whole thing because you're not doing it. And we've seen that in two wins this year. So it almost seems like by necessity, but other teams are allowing them to do it more so than the Steelers are doing it to their opponent. Maybe not that, but they are looking to make plays on the ball, and they're doing it in timely situations, as Tomlin would say, on weighty downs. They're winning those more often than not. At the same time, though, you see total collapses and lack of communication in games like against Houston, where nothing is working for you, and you're not really fixing anything either. So, in some cases, I believe they are, but there are instances in which they're not either. They're a dangerous play-to-play defense, but they're not showing that they're a very consistent one at this point either.
So the game on Monday night was Green Bay and the Raiders, and Garoppolo and Love, not a scintillating quarterback matchup, and it played out that way. What is your opinion, now that we've got five games under everybody's belt, what do you think the level of play in the league is, and how smart is the league right now in terms of how it is being played?
I think, overall, that's a really interesting question. I would say it looks better at the top the last couple this year than it has the last couple years. You watch San Francisco play, that's just a phenomenal team.
No doubt.
And I thought Dallas was playing pretty well. Mm-hmm. They boat raced Dallas. I mean, that wasn't competitive. San Francisco is at a high level. Now, typically we'll see, you know, the front runner kind of, you know, maybe fall off a little bit while Kansas City picks up and do their cagey veteran thing and figure out ways to win every game.
Right.
We're seeing more teams put up great performances early, I think, than we have in the past.
Yeah.
The bottom is odd because you look at Cincinnati, and with biased glasses on, no one is going to think that Cincinnati is one of the worst teams in the game. But through Sunday, fairly, they were.
Right.
That wasn't a fluke. It wasn't an accident. It's not just, you know, well, Cincinnati isn't playing well. They were bad. They played like a very bad football team.
Mm-hmm.
At the same time, the team that they kind of, you know, maybe got right a little bit against, Arizona, is playing 10 times better than I thought they would.
Right.
So in one way, I think there might be a little more at the top, but it really seems to me like the bottom is a lot better than it has been in the past. Arizona, you know, by rights and by roster, shouldn't have won a game all year.
That's right.
I mean, that was a legitimate prediction from a lot of people.
Yep.
You see bad play. We've seen Denver a historically bad loss, and having to come back as much as they did the next week against Chicago, only to let it fall away. And Chicago themselves being a total train wreck. They just don't seem to be quarter to quarter, week to week bad the way we've seen in the past. So
right.
To me, it kind of seems like the bottom is a little bit better than it has been. And I think that increases some viability overall. Now, the follow-up question would be, why is Las Vegas on national TV so much? I have no idea.
I have no idea.
But that Packers-Raiders game was not – it was close. I'm not sure how good it was.
Right.
But Raiders are going nowhere fast, and that's kind of a maybe little bit of a surprise, but Green Bay probably won a little bit more early than what we're seeing them to be now. Not out-and-out surprises, but these aren't train wrecks either. I mean, Denver would probably be the leader in the clubhouse for the top pick as of right now. They seem to be the worst team overall. But I don't think, you know, 31 through 25 are terrible football teams either. That's just me.
Yeah. Any trend in the league that's a little different this year? I mean, there's always something where, like, okay, something becomes like baseball. Suddenly out of nowhere, you know, every pitch is a sweeper. Okay, great. It's not a slider or a curve. It's a sweeper. Anything you're seeing that's a little different trend that everybody seems to be picking up on?
I think we hear, put it this way, I think today's trend is the talking point of tomorrow.
Yeah.
And because of that, I really think the fact that an off season of consternation over injury, over pedigree, the fact that right now it's you can't to dilute it a little bit, you cannot have an MVP conversation right now without mentioning Brock Purdy.
Right.
The trend in that sense is, look at how many high-priced, high-acquisition quarterbacks have completely fallen apart. You know, Cleveland versus Denver is going to be the joke bowl next season, the pace that those two teams are on.
Right.
Meanwhile, the literal last pick of the draft is arguably the MVP of the league.
Yep.
Now, we can go back between two or three people, and if it's not Purdy, okay, but he makes a very strong case. I know that. How is that happening? You know, do we want to go as far as to say it's no longer high-end quarterback stats, not this complete massacre of a game, an assault of Patrick Mahomes throwing four dimes against the Raiders in the second quarter alone. We're not seeing that so much, but Purdy operates in such a way that he's not making bad reads. He's not making mistakes. How is that happening? And we'll argue chicken versus the egg all day. Mm-hmm. There is a certain amount of talent that comes with that. But Trevor Lawrence, with a great coach,
yep,
with a pedigree,
yep,
who's played a lot more than Brock Purdy has, why does he still struggle? You know,
right.
To me, it kind of brings up, you know, the marriage of coach and scheme kind of seems, mm-hmm, to be more, of scheme and quarterback. It seems like that's, you know, tomorrow's talking point and whatever that might be, because to put a point on all of it, Tua is the big gunslinging quarterback.
Yes.
Wasn't that the knock against him before? He doesn't have the arm.
Yep.
He's chucking up 40 points a game, and it's a great scheme. You know, it fits him very well. They went out and got guys to play within that scheme, and it's working very well. So, to me, the question comes into in a really deep quarterback draft, in my opinion, how much emphasis will a team's schematic philosophy go into drafting who they're going to draft? And along with that, what veteran quarterback that can't get it done anymore is going to be gone? And I guess the answer to me, both those questions, is, you know, Caleb Williams in Denver.
Right.
What would they do together? You know, and it's almost like Sean Payton saw this happening.
Yeah.
In a way. I don't want to propose that. We'll hear about that plenty, I'm sure.
Yeah.
But schematically, you could see Williams fit within what Payton has done in the past, and they can build up around that and create, you know, the anti-Purdy in the sense,
right,
of the first pick instead of the last, and go in and have a lot of schematic success because you got a player that fits very well in what you're comfortable calling, what you're comfortable coaching.
Well, and there's one other part, and I'll just make this quick because I know we're at the end here. Purdy had 4 years at Iowa State, played all 4 years. Okay, so all the great plays were on there, all the warts are on there. The flash in the pan guy that starts for a year and like flashes potential, the NFL seems to be drawn to that guy because there aren't as many warts. All right. And a guy like Purdy showed pro and con, and that's why I think people shied away from him.
Yeah, that's fair. Yeah. I would also put there has to be a good amount of emphasis put on the fact that they're not done developing. I know it seems like they should be, and this, a lot of it is reference to Kenny Pickett,
yep,
but they're going to continue to improve. They're going to continue to work and get better, and it's not just on the coach to do that. It is on the quarterback to do that, and I think Purdy should be commended,
yep,
for the fact that, and we've talked about this, you saw it immediately when he started playing with San Francisco. He is a way better player,
mm-hmm,
physically than he was at Iowa State.
Yep.
That's a fact. So he put the work in to become a better player. It's not just Shanahan moves the machines to these places and he knows to throw it here. He physically looked like a much better player, much more decisive. He had a much stronger arm.
Sir, always a pleasure, and you know that.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me, guys.
Neal Coolong. We'll come back, and we will talk with Tony Knopp next half hour. How you doing on gripes? You okay?
I got one out of the way already, but I have another one I saved just for you.
What was the one you got out of the way?
Oh, there was a report on Athlon Sports, that clickbait website, that accused James Franklin of calling out a Big Ten opponent when he talked about there was a team that, mm-hmm, was trying to get out of already agreed to contracts for future non-conference opponents. Mm-hmm. Because of the way things are shifting now, so I called them out on that lazy journalism.
Nice. Have you actually clicked on the Athlon thing? All right. We'll come back with more in a moment here on News Radio 1070 WK.